everybody. I'm Victor Stinner. I'm working for Red Hat. And I'm here to talk about how to engage Python contributors in the long term. Or say differently, tech is easy, people are complex. As an introduction, I have many people saying that Python is all about code, and I would reply, liar. Python is first about people. I would start my talk with the government. So the government is a short name for this depression. Usually it's related to war. And last year, in February 2018, we had a so what does it mean for me in practice? Because I unsubscribed from all Python mailing lists. For me, it means 7 mailing lists. I closed all my pull requests. I muted all notifications. And when I went to the doctor asked me to get away and see the phone for 1 month. And I made no commit for 3 months and a half. And for me, it's something really significant because I was one of the most active contributors in Python for over the last 5 years. So no commit for me is really something new, and I wasn't prepared for that. So it was really something different. And to give you an idea of the stage is for my comment, this is a typical email inbox before the download. And you can see that there are a lot of folders about Python. There is the build box, which is our CI to check for players. EPO is a bug tracker. You have the Bugzilla for Red Hat internals bugs. Committers, which is a list specific to Python for developers. Core Mentor is for mentorship. Python Dev is a general list for discussion about the Python developments. All notifications related to pull requests. Fine Mains is a Python maintenance team. That's my team at Red Hat. Fine Security are emails related to security. And the last one is a general mailing list about user asking questions of Python. And my way to work is that each morning I open Gmail to check my email, and I'm trying to read all of them. And I try to at least read them, but not always take an action like fix the bug. And at the beginning, it was just fine to have the zero inbox policy, because I didn't get much emails, but over the year I got more and more emails because I subscribed to more and more mailing lists, and at the end it was just too much. So what does the downloads mean for me is that I realized that it's time to step back from the Python project and think about how I'm involved in Python, and maybe there are some issues because I was feeling bad, and I realized that I just have too many responsibilities, not even on Python upstream, but also in my job. And I didn't realize that I was working 13 hours per day, which is too much. And this is an average, which means that some days I may work even longer. But a burnout is something complex, and I will not elaborate all the reasons because it's something also very personal. But it's just to give you an idea of what's going on. Okay, so let's come back to the open source. The problem of open source is that I don't scale. Even if I would like to spend more time on Python, I cannot because I have to eat, I have to sleep, and it's just not possible. So. Burnout make me realize that I don't scale, I need to change the way that I'm involved in Python. And from my point of view, there is an increase of the workload in Python in general. So there are more and more things to do. But there is a decrease of the number of new core developers per year. So on the top, you have a graphic on open bugs on Python over the last 7 years. the line on the top is the number of bugs, and the line below is bugs with patches, which is nowadays less relevant because we have pull requests. But previously, it was the bug which had a solution. So you have a lot of patches waiting for review, but nobody doing the review. And you can see that it has steadily increased. So it's only going up, it's never going to increase. And above, you have the number of new core developers per year. So you can since 10 years. And you can see that slowly there is less and less new core developers in Python. And in theory, it's not an issue because we expect people to work for the dedicate their whole life to Python, but now it doesn't work. People move to some other projects, some people decide to have children, some people decide to travel. So you cannot expect people to be involved over the last over 10 years in your project. You have to get fresh blood frequently. And in total, in the GitHub, in the Python project, we have almost 100 core developers in the Python core developers team. But this number includes inactive core developers, which means developers maybe didn't push any change for 1 year. And you have to compare this number to the number of bugs, which are almost 700, and the number of pull requests, which is now very close to 1,000. So you have 1,000 pull requests for a few active core developers. And I found this comic on the comicstrip.com website, which is a good way to explain the issue. So this is how you think that open source apps are maintainable. You can see that happy faces, you can see that maybe they had a party recently, there is someone bringing coffee, there are many people in the same room, so you can expect that they are working in a team, more likely inside a company. Some people are writing on a whiteboard, they are discussing an issue together, and in the front, there is someone who looks like a manager who say that, oh, I assign a team to blah, blah, blah. And being able to assign a team to someone means that there are already a lot of people, but there is even more people, resources available to fix more issues. This is how open source apps are really maintained. You can see that the two pixels are different. So what can we see here is that it's more likely the middle of the night, according to the clock. It's a single guy working alone with his cat. He's working from home, and he say that, oh, just one more ticket before going to bed. So what does it mean? That when you submit a bug to Python, when you submit a pull request, you have to know that one guy is alone at home with his cat and has to review your, has to trade his time and his sleep to review your contribution. And I often heard people saying that, oh, in Python we are all volunteers. Let me elaborate this sentence. All volunteers means that a contributor gives their free time to Python. Free time can be evening, weekends, maybe you're also part of their night for a few people. And we have all unlimited amounts of free time. So it means that if you take the free time to work on Python, you have to take it from someone else. So it means that you have to trade your time between your family and friends on Python, and you have to find the right balance between the two, not lose family and not lose friends. And sadly, only a few employers allow the employee to contribute to Python upstream. But there are a few companies who allow that. I'm feeling very, very lucky because I'm paid by Red Hat to contribute to Python upstream on a downstream. I'm paying Python. And I pay full time. But sadly, I am the only one. At Microsoft, there are four core developers, Jeff Cannon, Barry Warsaw, Eric Snow, and Steve Lomont, who have 1 day per week dedicated to open source. And at Dropbox, there is Guido Van Rossum, the author of the Python language, also have 1 day per week And if you put all these people together, you get only two full-time developers working on Python. And you have to compare this number to the popularity of the Python language, because there is a website called TIOP, which is a popularity contest of the programming language using different ways to measure the popularity. And according to them, Python is the first most popular programming language in the world. So it's the third one, and we only have two developers working paid to work on Python. And it's very common that people ask me why nobody review a specific pull request or why nobody have a look at a bug report. So you have to know that reviewing a patch or managing a patch as a host, which is not very obvious as a contributor. And Breakenon found a nice analogy to explain that, is that you have to think of a contribution like a puppy. You might view it as this, oh, this cute, wonderful thing you are giving for free. When I'm looking at it as over a decade of feeding, working on web pages. So what does it mean for Python? Is that when you click, when a code developer click on the merge button, the one who click on the button becomes responsible of your code. And it's not only for today, it's for the next 5 years, or maybe up to the next 10 years. Because each time that there is a regression in the part of the code that you modified, the one who click on the merge button has to under regression and try to understand the code, try to understand why there is a new failure. So there is a cost in the long term. And that's not very obvious when you propose a contribution. We made actions in the past to try to engage contributors in the long term. And one of the big actions was that the Python Software Foundation paid Breadcannon to write a guide called the developer guide to explain how to create a pull request, where the bug tracker, how to run the test, everything that you have to know to contribute to Python. And we migrated from Mercurial hosted on python.org to Git hosted on GitHub. And the reason was not to move to Git. The reason was mostly to move to GitHub because previously we had a very workflow very specific to Python. We are only using our own bug tracker and you have to attach a patch file to the bug tracker. And not all projects use this method so for contribution. But GitHub today is very popular. People know how to use it. They all have an account. They are used to push a pull request, to push new changes. It's something very popular, and we just decided to move to GitHub to reduce the burden to push the first pull request. And I think that this is a great success because from my point of view, we got more and more contribution over the last 2 years since we migrated. And another important change is that previously, the core developer who picked your patch on the bug tracker had to run the test manually. And also, after pushing the change, if something is right on the build, he has to understand the failure and try to fix it. So it means that previously, fixing the bug was the job of the one who merged the change. And today, we changed that to give the responsibility to the author of the change, because we run the CI as a pre-commit on the pull request directly, on Linux, on Windows. So it doesn't mean that you are alone to fix your issue, because anyone can help you to understand why the test failed, how to fix it. But it means that we better scale, because we put less tasks on the one who are limited, who are the code developers. But sadly, even if we made all these actions, I think that there is still still an issue and core developers remain the bottleneck for the velocity of the Python development. I like this quote that you can't solve people's problems with software. Because we try to put more and more toolings on Python, but it's not enough to get new people on board. Okay, now I will would like to talk about the diversity of programs. So first of all, I heard very often that, oh, there is no public complaint, so there is no diversity problem. Oh, that's all. And it's not that easy. So to introduce the topic, this is a tweet from Maria Tadijaya, who is a Python core developer. She wrote, when women speak out about diversity of the community, they get penalized and branded as non-technical. Some women choose not to speak out because of this. We will not be silenced. And even if we are working on that, I still think that Python is a toxic community in some ways. And toxicity can mean different things. For example, when someone proposes an ID on the Python IDs mailing list or Python dev, there are still attacks directly on the author of the ID, an attack to the core person, instead of staying at the argument level. And this is not a good way to discuss, to make Python a better language. We have to stay at the argument level and not to attack people. Attacks can occur on the public space, but they may continue in the private space. And sadly, sometimes it only happens in the private space. So it means that people get harassed in their private emails or private Twitter account, for example. But nobody is aware of that. And if nobody is aware of that, we cannot work on this issue. And I will explain why later, but when people are harassed, they don't speak up because it's very difficult to talk about that. And so nobody is aware of the issue and it's not going better. And toxicity can mean burning, lying, misogyny, and racism. And to give you another very concrete example, is that so last year there were different discussions about databases. Because to get high availability, usually you need different databases, like the one who gets the write operation and another one which is a copy, just in case of the first one fails. And in the past, they used the master database or the slave one database, but some people started to say that maybe it's not the most appropriate word for that. It's better to say the primary and secondary database. So some databases started to move to the new terms, primary and secondary. And when I looked at Python, I realized that sometimes the master and slave terms are not used properly. For example, I modify the code for the process, and when you have a process, usually the relationship is called parent and child, and not master and slave. Or for a network connection, usually I'm using the terms client and server, not client and master. Or for buildbots, they changed the name from build slave a few years ago, and the current correct term is buildbots workers. And I also modified these terms because a slave can mean slavery to some people. So it's not a good idea to use such term in a programming language because it's not related to slavery. So I just modified 7 lines in the documentation and in comments. It's just 7 lines. And according to people who include my change, the change makes sense because the new term is better. But a journalist wrote an article in the news website called The Register. Very quickly after these articles, more and more articles have been written about this topic. Russia Today, Breitbart, Technopay.com, Hacker News, Motherboard, this, Slashdot, 4chan, West China, Twitter, Weibo, and many others. And articles have been written in English, Russian, Japanese, Mandarin, German, French, Czech. And all these articles mention my full name and my employer. To give you an idea of the volume of messages, just on Slashdot, in 2 days, people succeeded to send 1,200 comments. So I don't know how they are doing that, but they are very efficient to send comments. And I would say that the reaction online was not really positive. It's negative or very negative. And the worst comment can be found in the 4chan. So this is an example of a comment that someone wrote on the 4chan. On 4chan, everybody is anonymous. This comment is, "Fuck you, Victor Stinner, who has an enemy of slash G now, shit. I will probably make a video about this speech." And someone is even more violent and more direct. "I would like him dead." Okay.
One question. Can we make such comments like, "I want someone something" within the code, or some abusive opinion, but as comments part of the code?
I'll let you read the article if you want to know more about this talk. Huh. So I would like to take a short break. Another rebel corner, because to be honest, I never expected such bad reaction on a very small, tiny change, which I mean in the documentation. But it seems that many people have very strong opinion about this topic. And I did not expect a news article in, to mention my name in such a news article, because Python is a tiny programming language, it's not related to politics. But it seems like people are offended by this topic in some way. Okay, we solved all these problems, so let me introduce you the diversity solutions. To understand the diversity issue, you have to understand that we are not talking about programming anymore, we are not talking about tech, we are talking about people. And to understand people, one good tool is psychology. There is something which becomes more and more famous called unconscious biases. So they are social stereotypes about certain groups of people that individuals from outside their own consciousness are less. Written like that, it's not easy to get it. But the important part is that it's something inside, it's outside your own awareness, so you are not aware of that. So even if you try to fight against that, it's part of you and you just have to accept it. And it's not easy to understand that because it's something that's obvious. But I heard that the machine learning nowadays becomes more and more popular. And there was a study in the US made by some policemen to develop a software to analyze profiles of people. So they feed machine learning with a lot of different files from criminals. And once the software was ready, they tried the software. And they realized that the software was racist. It means that if you take two files of two different people with a very similar profile, the software we said that the black people is more likely a criminal than the white people. And machine learning for me is something very stupid because you put in, you send inputs, you get outputs. So if the output is not expected, maybe it comes from your inputs. So what I'd like to say is that this machine learning is like a mirror that you put in front of you and you look at yourself. It means that if this machine becomes racist, it's maybe because yourself you are already racist. And something else about some psychology is impostor syndrome. So impostor syndrome is a psychological pattern in which an individual doubts their accomplishments and has a persistent internalized fear of being exposed as a fraud. And again, it's something inside you, it's a persistence, so it's very difficult to get away from that. But again, it's not easy to get it directly. So what I like to explain it with social networks, because today. We are all using social networks like Facebook, Instagram, Pinterest, and many others. And more psychologists say that on such a social network, we are trying to show the best of ourselves. We are trying to hide our weakness. And because of that, psychologists say that more and more people will get depressed because of social networks. Because when you compare your own life to the profile of your friends, you are jealous or you feel lower because your friends are traveling all around the world. They have amazing weekends, they are doing a lot of different activities, and your life looks boring. But it's not you, it's because of the way that the social network is managed. And I think that this thing is not something new, because even at work, when you compare to your colleagues, sometimes you can feel you cannot have the same feeling, because at work we try to show the best of ourselves. We try to hide our weakness. And when you compare your own work to the work of your peer, you can also feel that you are working less or your work is worse. Okay, something else for to work against toxicity, something called the code of conduct. But to understand what is a code of conduct, you have to rewind and come at the early age of open source software. At the beginning, it was a small group of people who know each other, and it was just fine. But slowly, open source becomes more and more popular, and we get more and more people on board. But we realized that even if we expect that all people are well behaving, in practice, it's not the case. There were more incidents. We saw that, for example, it's very difficult for a woman to be involved in an open source project. So we realized that maybe we have to write down some rules. And this is how we came up to the idea of a code of conduct. The Python Software Connection created a code of conduct, and it has been applied on a mailing list, the web tracker, and Python.org. When you have a look at the code of conduct, there is something simple, like you have to be respectful, you have to be kind with your peers. It's nothing crazy, in my opinion. And the code of conduct has been applied at the last Python events, because during events, you have physical meetings, and they can be different. Last year during Python US in May 2018, for the first time Python US used the service of a company to help to manage product conduct incidents. So what does it mean to use the service of a company? Is that it's not easy to know how to provide the best reaction to an incident. And the work that you can do is to not provide any answer or to make the situation worse. And nobody wants to make an incident worse. Usually, when you talk, it's just enough to handle the issue in private. There is no need to make it worse. And I think that it was a great idea to have a company helping for that. And today, the PSF can require a code of conduct if you would like to organize an event called Python. The current state is that there are discussions about how to handle code of conduct incidents and bans, because sometimes they are bans, they are bans which are removed, but not everybody agree on that, or they don't understand why, because you may not be aware of all the discussion made in private. So we are trying to discuss how to provide a fair reaction to each incident. Come back to diversity, I would like to explain why I consider that diversity is something important in Python and why you need a diversity in your project. The diversity, for example, means the diversity of point of view, because Python is a very large project. There are many different things to do, and there is the documentation, but some people care more about the C language or reference counting. Or some other people care about the backwards and forward compatibility, or the API, the language consistency. Some people are very good to go directly to the solution, to try to find a simple solution and not to elaborate something very complex. Some people are really good to spot corner cases, which is important to examine accounts in the design of a new feature. Some other people care about performance, or security, API, and there are very different point of views. It's also the diversity of use cases, because there are different ways to use Python. You have, for example, command line interface running for less than 1 second. And for such kind of application, what is important is the startup time of Python. So we have to reduce the startup time to make the application more efficient. But some other people are using servers running for multiple days or even multiple weeks. And for such server, what is important here is more is memory usage. Make sure that the memory footprint remains stable or not weak. There are also graphical interfaces, machine learning, REST server, games, and again, there are many different use cases. But to give you a more concrete example, Naoki Nada has been promoted as a co-developer in 2016. He's coming from Japan. And he has been chosen for as a BDFL delegate, which means that he is the one who takes a decision on a PEP, a Python change. And he has been chosen for the delegate of PEP 538, which is a C local of Croatia, but also my PEP 540, which is a new UTF-8 node. And what you can see here is that English speakers are satisfied with ASCII. ASCII is a boring language, there are a few letters, and ASCII is just fine for them. But maybe Japanese people are more used to encoding issues because there are many more characters. They are using different encodings and computers. And getting encoding issue is something very common for them. So they have a very good reason to want to work on that topic. And I think that it's very important to have people speaking different languages because if you miss, for example, the Japanese people, maybe you will miss some users and your software will miss many users. Another efficient way to get more people on board is called mentoring. And I would like to start with positive action. So during PyCon US 2016, Willow Van Rossum encouraged a woman to contact him for mentoring. And he mentored Marietta Vijaya, who became the first woman co-developer in January 2017. And you can see that, first of all, a co-developer has been promoted in only 6 months, which is quite quick compared to some other people. So it was efficient. And you can also see that before this positive action, we had no woman. So maybe something was wrong, and maybe you have to open your window to women. Because if you don't do that, women will not come to your project. So I think that it was a very efficient way to get more diversity in the project. And hopefully, after Marietta, we got more women on board. May of 2017, we got Carol Winning, who has been promoted. Last September, during the PyCon Sprints Seattle, Lisa Roach and Emily Morehouse have been promoted as well. You can see that in 2016, we had no women at all. In 2017, we got 2 women co-developers. And the year after, we doubled the number of women. So it was really efficient to have specific actions to be more welcoming to women and to have dedicated mentoring for them. Because if you don't do that, you may just miss a woman. And I like this quote to understand the mentoring is if you give a man a fish and you feed him for one day, but if you teach a man to fish, and you feed him for a lifetime. What does it mean in the case of Python? As I I'm kind of scared because I cannot work more. So I have to adapt a new approach to contribution. And instead of trying to fix all issues in Python because there is just too many things to do, maybe I have to train people to explain them how to do the work themselves. Because if I'm able to train people and they become able to fix the bug, we will scale horizontally, which is what I would like to get. So for example, I mentored Pablo Salgado between January and June 2018, and he became a core developer in June. So again, it's only 6 months. And I got to know that for some people, it took 1 year, 2 years, in some cases 5 years to become a core developer. So what I just want to say is that mentoring is something really effective. And to understand why it is effective, you also have to understand that the development of an open source project is a matter of trust. Because, for example, when you create a new project, and you spend a lot of time on it, maybe you don't want others to touch your project because you don't want other people to destroy your projects. So you have to build a trust relationship with others to make sure that they are on the same page, they are going to be aware and to not break your toy. And building a trust relationship is something that takes a lot of time. You cannot build trust in a few hours. It takes a lot of exchange of talks, of review, for example. And in my experience, mentoring is very efficient to build this trust relationship in a shorter time. Another way to get more people on board is the Python communities. There are some dedicated communities for diversity. For example, there is Py Ladies, and their catchphrase is Women Who Love Coding in Python. They organize events in Australia, Brazil, France, India, Netherlands, Nigeria, and Taiwan. Their website is pyladies.com. This is an example of an event, and you can see that it's not limited to women because there are also men in the audience. And usually, the idea is to learn programming with a teacher. And the idea is also to meet other people, to share your experience and get help. Another community is called the Transcode. It's an event that aims to help draw attention to transgender issues through topic reviews every day. So again, the idea is just to meet and to work together, for example, for 1 day. One of the latest events was during Pylongodium last year in London. And their website is trans-code.github.io. This is an example with the creation of the trans.tech website, which is a previous website. I think that's one of the most successful communities is called Jungle Girls. And the catchphrase is we inspire women to fall in love with programming. And they organize more than 700 events all around the world, like Cameroon, Finland, France, Ghana, India, Japan, Spain, Switzerland, and many other countries. Their website is jungle.com. The Jungle, the name means that usually it's more related to the Django web framework. And it's an efficient way to learn programming because more and more people are using web, and Django is very easy to use, so it's a great success. And you can see that they are all enjoying programming, many happy faces. And to conclude, so we saw that we identified that core developers are the bottleneck for the velocity of the Python development. We are aware that Python has some people issues, but we are working on these issues because first we are aware of that and we are trying different solutions to to make the situation better. Mentoring is efficient to train contributors as future core developers, but mentoring is also very efficient to build the relationship, which is a key to trust someone, to promote someone as a core developer. This code of conduct reduces the toxicity of a community because we had no code of conduct previously and we saw that we need one. We need people to handle code of conduct incidents to make sure that the community is fine, is not toxic. And we have also wrote that increasing the code diversity is a very important goal to ensure the future health of Python. There is a famous quote from Wes Cannon, also used by Naomi Seder, which is, come for the language and stay for the community. I heard many women saying that they tried different communities, different softwares, and they really like Python, which is, because it's not perfect, there are still issues, but it's really a great community and many people are nice and kind. So what's coming next for the contributor? I'm working on a process to promote contributor as a core developer, because previously the goal to become a core developer wasn't obvious, and it took a lot of time, and we have to break down what are the conditions to become a core developer, and what are the good steps, and what can you do to become a core developer. So I already have a draft, but I have to write it as a proper path. I'm also working on a mentoring guide, which is a guide to explain what is mentoring, how to mentor, how much time it takes, how to find mentoring, things like that. I also wrote a contributor tutorial, which is a tutorial to explain how to contribute to Python. But this one is different from the developer guide because the developer guide is very, very long, it's very complete. But it's difficult to start from the beginning. So the idea of the tutorial is to take contributor by hand and explain them one step after the others how to contribute and not ask them to do all steps at once. And you can see the URL to the tutorial, cpython.core-tutorial.critical.io. And that's all for my talk, but sadly I will not take questions after my talk. So, thank you.